Welcome back for another episode. This is your host, AJ Adamczyk. Today on this episode that you're about to listen to, I sat down with Michael Gaeta. He's a huge, huge proponent here in the United States about choice for vaccines. Michael was a teacher of mine back in acupuncture school, and I reached back out to him because I wanted to come on the show and, educate us as practitioners on, helping our clients find options for, this episode's not about being for or against vaccines. It's about choice and it's about, having choice. Michael is a huge, huge proponent of getting, legislation and being involved in letting people have that choice out there. Also Michael has some awesome online courses, classes, and just videos out there. You'll hear us talk about it. And he has one course out there all about autoimmunity, things like that. So that will be in the show notes. And if you get my emails, it will be on the email. And if you don't get my email, sign up on acupuncturesonfire.com. And, you'll get all updates and a lot of great courses and classes that will be coming out within 2017. And a lot of people that I know that, send things out there like that. All right, so let's hear from Michael.
This is the Acupuncturist on Fire podcast, the only acupuncture podcast where you will hear from business insiders, fellow acupuncturists, and be inspired to be the best acupuncturist you can be. Now, here's your host, AJ Adamczyk.
Michael, welcome to the Acupuncturist on Fire podcast. I'm so excited to have you here today.
Thanks, AJ. Thanks for inviting me. It's great to be here today. Thank you.
Yeah, this is a pretty funny podcast here. Michael was a teacher of mine, I want to say in a business ethics class,
okay,
like 2008 maybe, or I don't even know what year, maybe five. I don't even know what year it was.
Sure.
And
which school was that, AJ?
Eastern School of Acupuncture.
Oh, Eastern School, sure.
Eastern School of Acupuncture in New Jersey.
About there for 7 years.
And one of the funny things was always that Michael's classes always had to start an hour later than every other class. What was the reason for that?
Oh, right. I'm trying to think. Going back a little ways. But,
you fly in from Colorado to teach.
It was flying in from Colorado. That's right. I had already moved. So if I had moved, it was 2009 that I moved to Colorado from New York City.
I think it was that year.
And so it was probably 2009. And that's just how the flights and all that worked out.
Oh, my God. It was so funny.
I know we had some late classes.
Yeah. It was awesome, though. But we always enjoyed your classes. You were always the most like organized and like professional. You had like your microphone, your PowerPoints and everything. Other teacher would walk in and be like, "Wait a sec, what am I teaching today?" You know what I mean?
Yeah, well, it's important to our profession's really important to me, and it's important that I do the best job I can to help people improve their patient care and the success of their practice.
Awesome, Michael. So for the listener that doesn't know who you are, why don't you share just a little bit about your background and maybe what you're doing and all those type of things?
Yeah, thanks, AJ. I've been practicing now a little over 26 years. I started as a massage therapist and then as a dietitian nutritionist, and now in the past 20 years as an acupuncturist and herbalist. And so my first career was actually in music. I played the piano for 10 years.
I always see
you
on Facebook playing the piano.
Yeah, I'm in the middle of the doing one song on each of the 12 days of Christmas. So I'm playing Christmas carols at my Steinway once a day, for people on Facebook and what have you. But anyway, that was my first career as in music, and I taught piano and as a church organist and did club dates and gigs and things like that. And that overlapped with the beginning of my practice in 1990, where I was doing body work and nutrition. And then Asian body work, Ama therapy, and then kept continuing my schooling and became a dietitian, nutritionist, and then an acupuncturist. And so that was my second career. I did that full-time for 19 years, was in full-time practice. And then the past 7 years, I'm in my third career, which is primarily education. So my life is all about teaching these days and training and education, and specifically to improve the patient care and practice success of our colleagues in the natural health professions. My belief, AJ, is that if all of us in the natural healing arts had successful practices, that we would actually see a whole culture shift towards a lifestyle that people would choose of nature first and drugs last. And I think we would create a culture of people who are much more vital and resilient, who made a difference in the world through their positive contribution in the world. I think we would see that culture shift towards that resilient population that chooses that lifestyle of nature first, drugs last. So that gets me up in the morning. That gets me pretty juiced. And so that's what I'm about these days is education.
I'm right there with you with that, with the whole shift. And obviously we probably all see it in our practices on a small level of people's mind shifting. You know, and we see one by one, or you know, we see big waves coming in of people wanting to naturally take care of themselves. And
yes,
you know, and obviously, you know, that's what we're here for, and everyone's listening to this podcast for that, is finding those gems and finding those reasons to grow our practice, to get better,
right,
to help more people. And it's all right. It's all big cycle. And obviously, as a bigger whole, that's what you're saying, is that big shift. And you know, I definitely do see it. And you know, I feel like as the world, or even our country, and as a whole, is just the we're moving towards the nurturing of ourselves and nurturing of the world, and people are moving away. But you know, the big business and the pharmaceutical companies are pretty tough to fight. So I don't know if we're gonna I don't know if we're gonna see that in our lifetime, but hey, you know what? Yeah. It's worth a try, right?
Well, I think how it's going to go, AJ, I don't think we can oppose the medical system. I think we just need to build a new one in parallel.
All right. I think
if we – because you can't fight the drug companies. They own the media. They own the government. They own, you know, public health authorities. They own the agencies. They own the federal agencies. They control the journals. Like, you can't fight that. But there's no need to, because what you and I are doing in our practices and what you and I are doing in education is helping to create a parallel system of natural health care where we're not fighting anybody. We're just building something new. We're building a new world.
We're lightning.
Rather than fighting the one that doesn't work.
Exactly.
And I think, you know, as we just build something new in parallel, it'll eventually replace the dysfunctional system we now have.
Awesome. So, Michael, let's just dive right into today's subject of vaccines. And it's a very near and dear thing to my heart, just because of, I grew up in a very natural, holistic household. My father's a chiropractor and was very against vaccinations and everything like that. And, you know, obviously it's a huge subject. We sometimes see it in the media. And I'm sure everyone listening to this podcast has had at least one or probably many patients ask, or they might be having a kid or have had children, hey, do we need knowledge about vaccines and everything like that? And, you know, I think that one of those – I wanted to bring you on to the podcast because I've always known as you being this guy out there that has a lot of really awesome knowledge about vaccines. And I think you really can help us as a profession to help educate our patients just on even like a little level of just giving them some very little nuggets to then help them make the right decision. We're not making decisions for them, but we want to just help them make – the right decision for them, and that's really what the key is.
Absolutely, that's a great topic, AJ. Thank you for inviting me.
All right.
And you are, since you're unvaccinated, and my kids are too, you are part of the genetic elite of people who have not had their actual, you know, genes altered in some way by the introduction of these foreign chemicals and proteins. So that's great. And so someday, you know, if you end up having kids at some point, you know, they'll be even more the genetic elite because they won't have their basic genetic makeup altered by these vaccinations. And I got into this just from, you know, I've had a family practice for 26 years. I've been treating kids probably for 25 years. And I just started seeing kids come in who had all these issues, allergies and neurological problems and autism and digestive issues and respiratory problems and a ton of allergies, food allergies, airborne allergies, you know, just all this stuff. And that, you know, it just seemed like, wow, you know, it's just a lot of kids coming in with this. And like when I were taught in school by our teachers, you take a good history and you get the timeline. And so I'd say, well, when did this start? And they'd tell me, you know, say it was a 6-year-old or a 2-year-old, for example. And I just one day it popped into my head. I was with a mom. She brought in her 2.5-year-old, 3-year-old son, who had all kinds of digestive problems and behavioral problems and delay and regression. He just wasn't developing well. Plus, he had all these digestive problems and allergies. And it just popped into my head. I said, well, when did this start related to his vaccines? And it was just an innocent little question. I'm just taking a history like you and I do every week with a new patient. And then she paused and she looked at, she just kind of got quiet. She looked at me. She said, oh, I hadn't thought of that. This started, most of these problems started within days or weeks of him receiving his 2-year shots, quote, the well baby visit, which is a vaccine visit. It's not a well baby visit at all. And so I said, wow, that's interesting. And so that was interesting to me. I learned that vaccines were safe. They were effective. They were necessary. They were wonderful. They save lives. They prevent disease, all this type of stuff. And then I saw, essentially, I kind of filed that away. And then not too long after that, another new patient comes in, a child, and I'm taking a history. And so asked the same question, got the same answer. The problem started after the vaccines. The issues, the health issues that brought them into my practice for nutritional care or whatever we were doing was immediately preceded by a vaccine visit. And the pro-vaccine crowd will say temporal association does not prove causality. They'll hide behind that. And technically, you could say that's true if it's an isolated case. But then when you see thousands and tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands of children experiencing adverse changes immediately within hours or days or possibly weeks after a vaccine, that's evidence. That's science. That is AB. That's XO, intervention outcome. And so now, here we are 25 years later, at least in my, little experience in practice.
Yeah, for sure.
And then I started asking questions. I said, wait, what does the science say? What does literature say? And I started looking around and reading and I was appalled. What I was taught was, vaccines are safe, effective, and necessary. I got all my vaccines. I was born in 1969. I got all the shots, which is a grand total of 10.
Yeah, it was 10.
And today it's 69 by age 6. And so we're giving this massively expanded schedule. And I assumed, I trusted the government to do the testing and the safety studies and all this to make sure that adding more vaccines to the schedule was safe and that they would test and do research as they do with all other drugs. And I found out that wasn't the case at all. And so first I was ignorant. Then I was surprised. Then I was pissed because it became clear to me that there was this very obvious agenda, which has been accelerating in recent years, of lying to the population, lying to the public to sell drugs. Now, I had seen this pattern before as a nutritionist looking at the cholesterol issue. We've been lied to for 60 years until recently that cholesterol was bad and caused heart attacks and strokes. And this is a complete lie. But they manufactured a story, a narrative, a marketing story to sell cholesterol-lowering drugs. And they turned the most helpful, benevolent, protective molecule in the body, cholesterol, that's made by all animal cells, into this horrible substance that's going to kill you. They had to fabricate that idea to sell these drugs. The same exact thing is happening with vaccines. And before cholesterol was tobacco, it was cigarettes. They created this narrative and made up science and created false evidence and what we call junk science, tobacco science. And for decades, the medical profession and public health maintained that cigarettes were not only safe but helpful to protect. You can look at the ads in the Journal of the American Medical Association from the 1930s even. Cigarettes are your protection, your throat protection against irritation and cough. And then saying, oh, I'm a medical doctor and we have all the science, all the evidence that proves cigarettes are safe and good for you. And it's all manufactured bogus junk science. Exactly the same thing happened with cholesterol. Exactly the same thing happened with vaccines. They're fabricating junk science and junk evidence and just making stuff up and creating a marketing campaign to hoodwink or lie, deceive the population. And the bottom line truth, AJ, and we can go into the details about this, is that vaccines absolutely, and the evidence is irrefutable, vaccines do much more harm than good. Can you prevent a few cases of mild childhood diseases like chickenpox? Who cares? Can you prevent a few cases of these mild, self-limiting, non-fatal, non-dangerous, immune-building childhood diseases? Yeah, you can suppress a few cases of that, and you can suppress that in the population for a time temporarily, but at the expense of what cost? And now vaccine injury is now, you know, an enormous percentage of the childhood population, way beyond autism. But now we're faced with a crisis, and this is really, we can talk about this as much as you like, but now we're in a crisis point, the greatest health freedom crisis in U.S. history, where the forced vaccination crowd, the pro-vaccine crowd, wants to force, without choice or informed consent, unlimited vaccines on the entire population, children then adults, because the adult mandates are coming for unlimited mandated no-choice boosters. They're starting with hospitals, they're starting with health professionals like you and me, and now it'll be expanded to the whole adult population, to force with no consent, no voluntary choice, no parental rights, to force unlimited drugs on unlimited, the 28 vaccines roughly that are used now and the 276 that are in development and clinical trials now. They want to force unlimited vaccines on the entire population, all the children, all the adults, without any choice or consent. That's the issue. So we can talk about vaccines good, vaccines bad, and we could debate about that, and we could get people who are pro-vaccine and get some pediatricians on the Skype call today. That's all good. We could argue vaccines bad.
Yeah.
But the central issue, more important than that, even more important than that, is that the issue of personal sovereignty, the issue of parental rights.
Yeah, making the choice. That's the major thing.
The choice is the main issue.
You know, the main issue is making the choice, being allowed to make your own choice.
Absolutely.
And then if you make the right choice, or if you're making the choice,
yeah,
you know, is there safer choices? Is there, like, the ingredients that are added into these things? Is there maybe, you know, because obviously, you know, just like the information you just gave us, there's a lot of, you know, we're being told that we need to do this. We have to do this. There's, you know, if not, your child can't go to school, or your child can't play sports. Your child can't go to even daycare. I need to work. My child needs to go to daycare. Like, I'm not saying myself, but there's a lot of people out there that are being forced into doing it because of their own lives.
Yes.
So if they are going to be forced into doing this, Michael, are there safer choices out there? Are there alternatives? What are our choices, Michael?
Yeah, well, it's a good question, AJ, and I don't know if there's a single clean answer. What I would say first is the forced vaccine agenda, which has played out most dramatically last year in California, with the elimination of all but medical exemptions to vaccines, is the agenda for the whole country. And most doctors who write medical exemptions to vaccines, blanket exemptions to all vaccines, lose their license. They are subject to disciplinary action. They are brought up by their medical boards
if they don't do vaccines.
And this happened I lived in New York City for 40 years, and there was a physician, an internist, practiced for 20 years in Long Island, and you know, maybe an hour from you in New Jersey, who started writing because she did the research. It's amazing to me, and I'm not down on doctors at all. I'm not down on, you know, even drugs for that matter in general. They're just overused. I'm not down on the doctors, but I can say this. Having trained, you know, 15,000 health professionals nationally over the past 23 years of teaching, I can tell you this, that the most physicians, not because they're bad people, they just don't bother to read. They don't bother to ask questions. They don't bother to question what they're being told. They do not bother to read the medical literature. It's easier to just put the blinders on. Well, the CDC says this, so it must be true, and just believe whatever they're told. this is one doctor, and there aren't that many around, who didn't do that and who actually did the reading and did the research, looked at PubMed or whatever journals, you know, there are available, and looked at Science Direct or whatever it is, read the literature, the actual medical studies, was horrified at the amount of evidence there is of harm and the risk and the history, which proves that vaccines had nothing to do with the elimination of any epidemic, from smallpox to polio to whatever, had nothing to do with the elimination of any epidemic at any time, and said, you know what? I'm going to use my as the ethical, responsible thing to do, knowing what I know now as a physician, as a scientist, I'm going to start writing medical exemptions. So parents would come to her and get blanket exemptions to all vaccines. Well, they took her license away. She can no longer practice medicine after 20 years. And so this is, you know, just part of the medical mafia keeps the doctors in line in that way. And so I want to say, to answer your question, first is the fight isn't over. And the fight isn't against vaccines. The fight is for choice. Fighting against vaccines is valid, is worthwhile. I think, you know, being anti-vaccine, you can definitely support that scientifically based on the evidence, the objective, credible evidence, not the junk science from the CDC, but the real science, the real evidence is super clear that vaccines do more harm than good. You could take a stand against vaccines, but you're going to have a much better effectiveness to take a stand fighting for parental rights, informed consent, healthcare freedom of choice, and personal sovereignty. So that's step one, is to get active, get involved. And I would recommend to our colleagues and their patients to go to a website. There's two that I would recommend. One is nvicadvocacy.org.
Can you say that again, Michael?
Yeah, NVIC advocacy, advocacy.org. And that's a free private service where you can just put in your, you know, register there, put in your state, and they'll tell you what's going on by email just when there's something going on in your state that is threatening parental rights and informed consent and healthcare freedom of choice, vaccine choice. And get involved, get active. I've sat in legislators' offices talking to their staff and the usual, you know, emails and phone calls, but they're very receptive if you actually bother. And so we all need to start bothering. Where you are in New Jersey, where I grew up in New York, definite activity by the medical establishment to eliminate all choice, to eliminate religious consent, eliminate religious exemption, eliminate philosophical exemption in the states where that remains. So number one is to get active and to fight, not against vaccines, but for choice. Number two, to answer your question, is where necessary to seek medical exemptions. What I've heard in California is that the state medical board has told the physicians they will not be persecuted or prosecuted or disciplined for writing medical exemptions. We don't know if that's true. But step one is the fight is far from over, and more people are waking up that the CDC has been lying to us for decades. The government, public health, drug companies, FDA, everybody's been lying to us for decades about vaccine dangers, and we need to take a stand, very, very forceful stand, not against vaccines, but for choice. So that's like big thing number one of what exactly to do. Beyond that, you know, I don't know what I would do. If I live in Colorado now, I live in Boulder. Colorado has philosophical and religious exemptions. If we lost that somehow in Colorado, I would probably just move to a state where there was the existing exemptions, religious or philosophical. When I was in New York, my kid was in preschool, and we just filed a religious exemption form, and that was the end of it. It was a private school. Public school is a little harder. You got to be able to be willing to fight a little bit. But where this is at is this is an ethical issue. And that's, you know, kind of step one is to fight for your right to choose.
All right. So, Michael, real quick, though, let's go back to, you know, obviously not everybody has the easy access to just get up and move like you possibly are saying that you would do. So what if you know, let's go back to the actual vaccines and just go basic ones and everything like that. And, you know, from what I've been told is, I mean, the research I've done is that, you know, sometimes that the ingredients that they're putting in these vaccines are actually worse than the actual vaccine themselves. Some of the additives. And that there is possibly on the market that you can get on your own and then bring it to your doctor vaccines that don't have any of those additives. Is that true?
It may be. I don't know.
Okay.
I'm not aware of that.
Okay.
I am aware there are several homeopathic practitioners who are, what I've heard, being able to administer homeopathic remedies of some sort somehow that will stimulate an antibody response and therefore give you a positive antibody titer and therefore allow you to be exempt from receiving additional vaccines of that specific vaccine. So, you know, I am so clear now, you know, 25 years in, that there is no such thing as a safe vaccine at all. Maybe there's ones that I'm not aware of that you know about that don't contain aluminum and formaldehyde and, you know, what have you. But there are real quality issues. There are real safety issues with the vaccines that, you know, that introducing foreign DNA, introducing foreign proteins injected, and intramuscular is considered the same as blood exposure, direct into the bloodstream exposure, of these foreign proteins into immature immune systems is very dangerous. So even if you took the aluminum out, which again, a lot of vaccines would not really have any effects without the aluminum in the vaccine, just introducing an antigen, which is a foreign protein to stimulate a temporary antibody response, I just don't know if that would work. But if it does, great. Maybe I would go the homeopathic route first. And again, the states consider a positive antibody titer, quote, proof of immunity, which is ridiculous. It doesn't prove anything. It just proves that you have an elevated antibody to a something similar to that pathogen. It doesn't mean you're immune at all. So vaccination is not immunization. They're totally different things. A vaccine is simply the artificial triggering of a temporary immune response to a man-made pathogen. That's all. The vaccine effects are very temporary, so which is why there is no herd immunity. But anyway, I think the short answer is try anything to avoid vaccination, and I would initially think that possibly this is just what I've heard, that there are homeopathic practitioners who can accomplish that and give you a positive titer without introducing any actual antigen or any actual adjuvants like aluminum.
Okay. So that's an answer. That could be something that we can advise our patients to possibly look into.
For sure.
Because that's really what I'm looking for here is that, you know, just some answers that we can – because I know that there's probably, you know, we've all been sitting there, you know, with a patient on the table and saying, hey, I'm either pregnant or, hey, I have a child. I don't want to vaccinate anymore. What are my options? You know, because sometimes I've had patients that, you know, did the early ones right off the bat.
Yeah.
And then we're like – had a big awakening and said, oh my God, what am I doing?
They woke up.
Let's stop this stuff. What are my choices now?
Yeah. You know? So the main choice, Adam, in AJ, in 47 states, except Mississippi, West Virginia, and California, where there are no exemptions to vaccines except medical. And that's dicey because the doctors can lose their license potentially or, you know, go under disciplinary action. In 47 states, except Mississippi, West Virginia, and California, you can claim religious exemption, which – and there's no approved list of religions. It's just your own sincere religious beliefs. That's the exemption
that's
form that I've
always had to work it growing up. And the crazy part is listen to this. So I actually got I had to leave a Catholic school because you can't use a religious waiver in a Catholic school.
Yeah, that's illegal. Yeah, that's illegal. And I grew up Catholic. I was a church organist for 10 years. And anyway, that's completely illegal. And is and if you challenge that legally, you would win every time.
Yeah,
there is no approved list of religions. Tragically, the Catholic Church has actually been aiding the forced vaccination, no exemption mandate process.
The diocese are...
Yeah, what they're doing is illegal. For example, I was flying to teach a seminar in San Francisco. I'm in LaGuardia Airport, which was the airport I flew out of when I lived in New York. And I got a frantic call from a dentist not far from you a veterinarian, not far from you in New Jersey.
Okay.
Kenny Fisher, one of my all-time favorite people, amazing holistic veterinarian, Kenneth Fisher, veterinarian. And he's freaking out, and he's like, I just got back from the school nurse. And she said, because we were claiming religious exemption, his son's in public school, and they claim religious exemption, and the school health nurse, who are one of the main propagandists in this scenario, in reality today, will lie repeatedly. And one of the lies that the school nurse said was that you're Jewish, and avoiding vaccinations is not part of Judaism. So you can't claim religious exemption because you're Jewish. And I said, look, Kenny, just go back and say the law does not specify there's no law in any of the 47 states that gives you these religions are okay, these religions are not. It is sincere, personal religious beliefs, regardless of any or no religious affiliation. And I said, just tell her, that's the law, that's the statute. And that's what the law of New Jersey and in 46 other states says. And if you and tell the nurse, if she pursues that line of lying and misinformation and pressuring and coercing them, that your attorney has been notified and is prepared to take legal action against her personally and the school. And he went back, he said that, and that was the end of it. She handed him the exemption form, he signed it, and it was done. So the school nurses, like the pediatricians, and 80 to 90% of an entire pediatrician's income comes from vaccinations. They are trained to coerce, lie to, propagandize guilt and fear parents into vaccinating their kids. The pediatricians are trained to do this in their medical conferences. They're trained by the CDC. The school nurses are trained to do this. They're trained to lie and coerce and guilt and use fear to force vaccinations or to get parents to meekly submit to this unproven, untested, unsafe vaccine schedule.
Wow, this is it's pretty eye-opening, you know, all the information that is out there, but it's scary because, you know, just like you said about the tobacco and then the cholesterol, and the crazy part is, you know, they went from the cholesterol, the same company, then, you know, with statin drugs going to then Viagra because it lowered guys' testosterone. And, you know, it's a big cyclical thing with everything. And
it's huge.
It's very scary that because so many people, you know,
mentality. That's the guilt.
But the problem is it's all in everybody's heads and minds that you have to do it and it's necessary and it's almost... I'm sure
it's your public duty.
It's your public duty, but I'm sure that I can't even imagine the arguments and the conversations you've had about this stuff because I usually just try not to get involved. I just say, you know, to each his own, whatever. But at the end of the day, it's so scary though that with what is out there, you know, I can't even bring my dogs to boarding without getting them vaccines. Because I don't do that with my dogs. I mean, I've had my dogs, I've lived to seven. I have a cat. My father still has a cat that I grew up with that is 26 years old. Okay. I have a dog.
Wow.
I had a dog that lived to 19. another dog that lived to 20. And then my two dogs right now are the healthiest little dogs in the world, and they don't have any. And the crazy part is, and they're my own dogs now, and I can't bring them to a boarding when I go away, so I have to find someone to watch them. But it's so scary because you're forced. People are forced.
Yes.
It's that scary because it's like I feel like in a way with my dogs I'm feeling that way. And I can't even imagine the way it's going to feel like when I have children because because of the same situation. A lot of people I'm sure have this education, but they almost get coerced into it because of the enforcement of, okay, well now I can't even go to my job because I have to, because my kids are not allowed to go to daycare.
Right.
You know,
absolutely.
It's stuff like that. The scary, that's the scary thing, Michael.
It's true. And it's true.
Where it's just very, it's such a subject that it's so tough that where do we start as an individual, as a practitioner? And then where do we, and then also too, you know, I'm sure people in this, on this call that are listening to this podcast are saying, wait, you know, I have children or I'm having children or, you know, the same question they're asking themselves and then for themselves for their practice too.
Yeah. Yeah. And that reminds me, AJ, the second website I mentioned before, the first one was NVICAdvocacy.org. The other is Learn the Risk.
Learn the Risk.
LearnTheRisk.org, another excellent website. And they've been great because they've been buying billboards to put on highways telling people – you know, it's just giving them the truth.
Yeah,
the vaccines
educate.
Do more harm than good.
Just educate, you know.
Yeah, educate. And so the first step, honestly, is to make a decision. The first step is to decide to get informed. And that's a courageous decision because that means ignoring the lies and the propaganda in the media, right? And the media, mainstream media, so CNN, USA Today, Time Magazine, Anderson Cooper, the New York Times, all of the mainstream media,
Michael,
business.
Real quick, I watched an SVU, Law and Order episode the other day.
Oh, sure.
And it was all about this exact same situation about herd immunity and how a lady essentially almost got thrown in jail because she was telling other people that they should educate themselves. And then they should have the choice. And then they were
about vaccines?
About vaccines. It was an unbelievable episode. And the lady ended up getting brought to court and everything for telling other people that they should choose themselves. Like, it wasn't that she was saying don't vaccinate. She was saying choose.
Have and a choice.
They literally brought this lady into court. She ended up getting like, I want to say she ended up getting like, I mean, obviously, this is a false and a fake case, but obviously they're depicting reality.
Oh, for sure.
You know, and they're trying to, you know, it's a humongous show, and it was just showing how that they were showing that like they're putting people, everyone at risk by one person not being vaccinated. They're putting everyone at risk. Which, wait a second, if they're vaccinated, how are they at risk? If that's what they believe,
right? That's the lie.
If that's what they believe.
Yeah.
How is that true? That's what I don't get, you know?
Yeah, yeah. So herd immunity is a lie. And that's something we kind of need to nail. And herd immunity, and just to I'll pull up the what the lie from the CDC is. Here it is. So here it is from the procession of lies all on one website, vaccines.gov. Says, quote, when a critical portion of a community is immunized against contagious disease, most members of the community are protected against that disease because there is little opportunity for an outbreak. Even those who are not eligible for certain vaccines, such as infants, pregnant women, or immunocompromised individuals, get some protection because the spread of contagious disease is contained. And this is known as the new term is community immunity. That's the kinder, gentler term for herd immunity. And so this is a complete lie. And the reason it's a complete lie, there are several layers to this, AJ. Number one is that virtually all vaccines are given for mild, brief, self-limiting, non-dangerous, non-life-threatening, immune-building diseases like measles, chickenpox, mumps, pertussis, these are not dangerous diseases at all. The death rate from these diseases was virtually almost zero before the vaccines were even introduced. For example, and so measles, exactly 100 years ago, killed about 15,000 people in the U.S., which is a much smaller U.S. population. We had a dramatically smaller population, and 15,000 people died of the measles in 1915, around there. Since the peak in 1915, the death rate went down. Why? Not because of vaccines, they weren't available. Because of improved sanitation, nutrition, hygiene, better living and working conditions, people just got healthier. They had less, they had better hygiene and sanitation, they were eating better food. Clean water, number one vector of transmission of disease worldwide. And so the death rate went down every year until 1962. When in a vastly, like triple the population, maybe quadruple the population in 1962 compared to 1915, 400 people died of the measles. Not 15,000, 400. But still, people were getting the measles, but nobody was dying of it. In the 1940s and 50s and 60s, well, before, until 1963, measles was a normal, natural childhood disease, just like you and I probably grew up like, oh, you get the chicken pox. I still have my little chicken pox scar from when I was nine. Normal, natural, non-fatal, immune-building disease. Now, we know in Chinese medicine that the mother passes on not only nutrition, but also poisons to the child in the placenta and through breastfeeding. The child is given, unfortunately, not toxic environment. The mother passes on not just good things, but poisons, toxins, harmful chemicals into the baby. What's the baby going to do? The baby develops an infection to burn out what in Chinese medicine we will call latent heat or latent heat toxicity or blood heat. We get rid of that toxicity, that heat toxicity, through going through an infection, going through a fever, going through an illness. And so we burn out, you could sort of say, those toxins or clear those toxins. We know in Chinese medicine that fevers can be very therapeutic. You don't want to suppress a fever. You just want to protect the body and help the thing take its course. So we have these immune-building diseases which are being suppressed in the childhood population for no good reason. These vaccinated diseases are not dangerous. They are immune-building. Number two. The herd immunity is a lie from vaccines because vaccine effects, and again, vaccine is just a drug that stimulates antibody production. That's all. It doesn't improve your immune system. It doesn't make you stronger. It doesn't make you healthier. It doesn't give you a stronger immune system. It just stimulates antibody production, not even to the disease, but to a synthetic version of the disease, which is a little different than the actual wild infection. And this so-called protection, it's not protection at all, but this antibody stimulation lasts, in the case of pertussis or whooping cough, a few months. A few months after every month, as soon as you receive pertussis vaccine, you get an antibody stimulation, almost immediately, within weeks, your antibody levels go down, 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 down. And so within several months of receiving your pertussis vaccine, you have no antibodies. And therefore, no protection. This is true of every vaccine without exception. The average vaccine only stimulates antibody production for 2 to 3 years, at most 10, and that's it. That means that the vast majority of the U.S. population has had no vaccine protection, myself included. I finished up my vaccines probably 1975, so now we're 40 years out. I haven't had any vaccine protection for 40 years, and neither has anybody else who, who is over the age of whatever, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70 years old. They've had no vaccine effects for decades, and there have been no epidemics. We have not had a single epidemic in several decades, close to 100 years. Many, many decades. There have been no additional
epidemics. But then there's the argument, obviously, that they say it's because of vaccination. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely. So the talking about measles, AJ. Measles We went from 15,000 dead per year in 1915 to 400 in 1962. The vaccine only came out in 1963. So the entire reduction in death, we still had measles happening, but the death rate went to almost zero before the vaccine was introduced. Same thing with smallpox. We have the most smallpox in the communities in Europe, and we have the most data from Europe. We have some data from Australia. We have little data from the U.S. But you have the most smallpox in the most intensively vaccinated communities that received the vaccine. You had the least smallpox in the communities where there was no vaccination. And so that's a lie. And the death rate from smallpox was highest in the most vaccinated populations. Polio never went away. It was just redefined. The polio vaccine came out in 1948. At the same time, they changed the parameter of what the diagnosis of polio was. It used to be that you were diagnosed with polio if you had symptoms of paralysis for 2 to 3 days. They came out with a vaccine. They changed the definition of polio to you had to have paralysis for 45 to 60 days, narrowing the number of people who would get diagnosed with polio, making it look like the polio went down. But it didn't. It was just redefined. And the initial polio vaccine, as Dr. Salk testified to Congress, 74% of all the polio cases were due to the vaccine, the initial live oral polio vaccine. So to claim that polio eliminated polio vaccine eliminated polio is a lie. Now we call it Guillain-Barré syndrome. Now we call it acute flaccid paralysis. It was redefined, but the symptoms never went away, and the vaccine had nothing to do with it. Polio was well on its way out in Europe before the vaccine was even available.
Oh, God.
So there's no vaccine that ever eliminated any epidemic at any time in human history. It's an absolute lie. And we're on Skype, so we could do a – if you want to do a screen share, I'll show you a picture of what this looks like on my screen. Here it is. And let's see. How do we do – OC Plus, share screens. Which screen are we sharing? We'll share this one. Start.
How do I see your – oh. Yep, here we go. You're doing it.
You got it. Okay, good. So start. Okay, so we got that. So you're seeing this combined timeline?
Yes.
Okay, so I can make it bigger. Let me click on that. So here's the – oh, let me switch this out. Let me switch up and give you a bigger picture there, AJ. Here you go. I'm gonna make it bigger. Okay. So here is the death rate, not incidence, but mortality from these diseases. And I'll swap it out to make it bigger. So here's diphtheria. The death rate was coming down precipitously before the vaccine was even available. Pertussis was almost gone in terms of mortality, not incidence, but mortality, meaning people got pertussis. Who cares? They just got over it. And 1948, it was virtually no death from pertussis but before the vaccine was even available. Measles, in terms of mortality, was gone, almost gone. Compared to its height of mortality, it was basically gone before the vaccine was even available. And so the lie that vaccines saved us and prevent 3 million deaths a year, absolute, complete lie. It is not based in evidence or science. The book you want to get on this, just to give you all the details, this is a great one. Here's scarlet fever, very deadly disease 100 years ago. Here's scarlet fever, and a lot of people died of scarlet fever. And look at that, the death rate went down all on its own. There was never a scarlet fever vaccine. With no vaccine, scarlet fever went away. You look at tuberculosis. There was no vaccine for tuberculosis widely used, widely adopted. And it went away as a source of mortality with no vaccine. So the decline in death from all of the, quote, epidemics happened regardless of vaccination. So that's an absolute lie that vaccines saved us from anything.
A book.
Here's the book.
Okay.
It's written by a nephrologist Dr. Suzanne Humphreys. It's called Dissolving Illusions, and it's a book of medical history. It's data, facts, and history for the few who are willing to read it and be awakened to the facts, the truth, not the lies, not the CDC propaganda, not the lies from your pediatrician, because without vaccines, the pediatrician's out of business. But this is a book that carefully documents how all of the epidemics were eliminated due to improvements in nutrition, sanitation, hygiene, living and working conditions. Had nothing to do with any vaccines at all.
Awesome, awesome. So why don't you go back and maybe unshare the screen real quick?
Sure, happy to. Let me do that.
So Michael, this information's been awesome that you've given us, and for myself and along with the audience here. And, I know you are a huge educator. You mentioned that, your major thing right now is education.
Yes.
So why don't you share with the listener exactly, what other education you do? I know you have seminar series, you might have some books out there. Where else can we find you? And, do you maybe give a full seminar on these vaccines? Because I know you just gave us a little taste here.
Yes.
And, you gave us a little... maybe you sparked some people's minds on, wait a second, maybe I should dive a little bit more into this. Or help my patients make an informed decision. That's absolutely the major thing here, I think, that, because obviously we're trying to help the big picture here.
Yes.
As practitioners here, it's obviously we'd love to make our own good decisions with these things, but it's really about helping our patients and clients on the tables to make that informed decision.
Absolutely.
We're not going to try to force them to say no to vaccines, but we want to help them make the right decision and give them the literature, give them the sites to go to. Hey, go to these sites. You make your decision.
Yes.
I'm just going to help you make that decision. So why don't you tell us maybe the seminars and things like that you do?
Yeah. Thanks, AJ. I still practice part-time. See patients here in Boulder, and also have a telehealth practice. But full time, I'm into education. And to answer your questions, I recorded a public presentation on vaccines, which goes through much more. It goes through all of the 12 vaccine myths. We touched on, I think, two or three today. There are 12 vaccine myths that people need to know about in order to make an informed decision. And goes through all this, the evidence, the science, the resources, all the data. So folks can just go to michaelgata.com, my public site.
I'll link everything on the show notes and everything for that for the listener.
Yeah, just go to michaelgata.com. At the bottom of the homepage, there's a home learning program for the public. And then there's a companion training, which is just for health professionals like acupuncturists, which is on what to do instead of vaccines, since vaccines are not safe and effective or necessary. What can we do to support the immune system to prevent infections? How can we support our patients who develop infections? So those are very inexpensive programs that are available right on the homepage, actually at the bottom of michaelgata.com. Second thing is, I'm very passionate about this subject. I've been lecturing nationally on vaccines for 14 years. And so I wrote a little booklet on vaccines that I'd love to give to all of our colleagues, all your listeners for free, with my appreciation. And I'll also keep
you,
folks,
Michael,
informed about my upcoming seminars and teaching schedule and writings. So they can just go to michaelgata.com, same thing. They can click on Contact Us and say Send Vaccine eBook, and we'll send people the book. No charge. Just with my appreciation for what you're doing and to support your listeners, our colleagues.
Thank you so much.
And then also keep you informed about upcoming events. And I also have one of the consequences of vaccines is we are now in the U.S. the epicenter of autoimmune disease. We now have 1 in 5 Americans has an autoimmune disease, and that number is going up. And one of the reasons, not the only reason, just to be clear, but the biggest reason why we have more autoimmune disease per capita than any other nation on earth is because we give the biggest vaccine schedule of any nation on earth with, by the way, no improvements in health outcomes. Just what we give on average triple the number of vaccines as other advanced nations, and we do not have any better health outcomes. We actually have worse health outcomes.
You ever see the picture? I see once in a while floating around social media. It's like the schedule of like a, I want to say it's like a doll, and it has like all 69 shots.
Yes.
And the doll, it's like, it's crazy.
Oh, it is crazy. We're vaccinating babies actually who can't make antibodies.
Yeah.
With drugs that stimulate antibody production, which makes no sense at all. It's ridiculous. There's a lot of money involved. It's a $50 billion a year industry globally now. And now they've got another 200, close to 300 vaccines on the way. So if you lose choice, you're really screwed, because you're going to lose choice for the future vaccines, not just the ones we have now.
Yes.
So number one is a public and a companion health professional training at michaelgated.com. The second thing is the ebook, which I'm happy to send anybody who wants it for free, and also keep you on my updated about my schedule through email. And I also have an autoimmune training, 6-week course just for practitioners, mostly, and a lot of them are acupuncturists, in autoimmune disease. You really have to know. I mean, honestly, AJ, I think if as a practitioner, if you don't understand autoimmune disease, how to prevent it, how to reverse it, you can't treat today's patient. And so having seen that, you know, as I travel the country lecturing, I realized, you know, I really have to reach, I have to help more people than I have been. And so I created this online course for practitioners, 6 weeks in autoimmune disease. That's coming out actually later this month.
Awesome.
So again, same thing, just go to michaelgated.com, let us know. We'll let you know about it. When it becomes available. We're finishing it up, and it's a 6-week course. We're going to do live calls every week on autoimmune disease.
That's super exciting. And also, don't you do some stuff with Standard Process too?
I do. Yeah, I'm one of their top speakers nationally, so I do a lot of trainings for them. In my practice, I use Standard Process. I use MediHerb for my Western herbs. And for my Chinese herbs, I use QualiHerb, and their website for our other acupuncturist friends is QualiHerb, QualiHerb.net. QualiHerb.net is where I get my Chinese herbs.
Awesome.
That I combine with my Standard Process supplements and my MediHerb. They come from Australia, Western herbs. So that's that. And then, I do trainings all over the country. I have a full speaking schedule this year. I have about 26 major events this year. I'll be speaking at the Integrative Fertility Symposium in Vancouver.
Lauren Brown.
You have Lauren Brown. Yeah, Lauren's an old friend.
He's been on the show twice.
Yeah, he's great. Lauren and I go way back, and I have a few excellent courses for acupuncturists on Pro-D seminars.
Awesome.
On ethics and Western herbs and thyroid and adrenal and other clinical topics. But most of my time, AJ, these days, I've created a 1-year certification program for mostly acupuncturists in natural functional medicine. So we have chiropractors and physicians and naturopaths and nutritionists, but most of the folks in this program are acupuncturists like you and me who want to learn how can I get better results in less time to help my patients more and have a more successful practice on the business side using natural functional medicine. So using nutritional supplementation, using herbal therapy, using lab testing, using diet and lifestyle counseling. So this is it's called the Clinician's Mastermind Circle. And the website, which explains the whole curriculum and we have 12 guest faculty and all of that, is called clinicianmastermind.com. And what I would recommend, if anybody's even interested in getting really good at nutrition and also, you know, learning not just the clinical but the business side and learn how to run and grow a successful practice, which I've done for 26 years, and I want to share what I've learned, and then also the self-development piece. So those are the three areas, clinical, business, and self-development, that we train people in. And so it's a wonderful course. You earn your certification in natural functional medicine after a year. We also get 30 NCCOM credits. But it's a great program, and I would just encourage people to go to clinicianmastermind.com and just click apply here, fill out the application, and then I'll personally, you know, talk to whoever it is just to see if it's a good fit. It's not for everybody, but my thing is if you read a little bit about it, if you think you might be interested, fill out the application, then we'll just get on the phone and talk about it and see if it's a good fit for you and see if you're a good fit for the program. But that's an amazing program where we have a 12-month clinical curriculum, 12-month business curriculum, 12-month self-development curriculum. We have 2 live calls each month, a 4-day retreat in the summer, 12 guest faculty. It's an amazing program. I've been working on it now for 4 years. We've had it out, and that's really awesome. So that's like kind of the main thing that I do these days is do training in that program, as well as create the autoimmune course that'll be coming out soon. And then I have 3 self-study programs for people who just want to study on their own. One is in clinical mastery, the other is in business mastery, and the 3rd is total practice mastery, which includes all of that. So we'll send that to you. You know, you just go to michaelgaeta.com, click on contact us, and we'll just send you information. If you think you might be interested, you just want to learn more about it, if you think it might be a good fit for you to help you improve your patient care and practice success.
Michael, that's awesome. I think that, even if one practitioner, I mean, I'm hoping that, you know, probably hundreds from this call, you know, click on that and check it out. But, you know, just helping those one, you know, we just one and then gets that information.
Yes.
It helps. How many more people can they help?
Yes.
And that's really what it's about. And it's so awesome that, you know, and I think this mastermind thing that you were speaking about sounds really interesting. I'm definitely going to check it out myself. And, you know, obviously the 6-week autoimmune disease, just like you said that, you know, if you don't master the autoimmune these days, because 1 in 5 people have issues with it.
On the averages, you know, 1 in 5 of your my patients have autoimmune conditions.
It's one of those things that, you know, I feel like, you know, I've kind of mastered pain in my practice. It's something
great.
I treat all day, every
excellent.
Day. And, you know, yesterday I think I saw 27 patients of just everyone was pain in my practice.
Wow.
And I'm starting – I'm not saying that I'm getting bored of it.
Sure.
But it's starting to get to the point where it's not lighting the fire anymore.
Yes. Yes.
And you know, it's one of those things that, you know, I've really loved it. And that's, I'm going to start maybe doing some teaching on pain management and some neurological
Great.
Stuff that I do.
Great.
I do a lot of E-stim medical acupuncture.
Oh, nice. Nice.
I studied a lot with Nowicki, Dr. Nowicki. I did some like
studies
with him and dived.
Heard a lot of great things.
And Alejandro Eli Ortega and stuff like
those
guys.
Yes, so heard good things.
I'm actually going out to study with him for a week personally with him this week coming up.
Nice.
January 31st to February 5th. And we're dissecting a body and doing understanding every
right
little aspect,
that's great.
Every little aspect of the body of where we're putting that needle and everything like that. So
yes.
I'm kind of really into that. But I've also, on the other hand, is, you know, these patients that are coming in with pain, they also have other issues. And I feel like those are the things I'm not nailing on these people. You know, nailing the pain, but I'm not getting the other problem.
Right.
I'm not getting
that's the whole internal medicine piece. Yeah.
Exactly. And that's what it's I'm not my whole goal is to just help people.
Absolutely.
And, you know, and that's
you and me both.
You know, at the end of the day, success for me is helping and giving. You know, that's
changing
really
life.
The key, the key to life is giving, and that's really, you know, Tony Robbins. You know, that's the key to life is giving, and it's like, you know, that just excites me, and that's what lights the fire for me, and I'm feeling I'm not getting that piece of some of the patients. I'm not, and I'm sure so many other people listening to this right now is like, wait a sec, I'm right there with you. Is, you know, I'm so good at this one thing, but, you know, these
that's
other
right.
things, it's just not there yet. You know, I've some patients come in be for a post knee operations, you know, pain management, nail that. But wait a sec, they're still coming to me because they have depression. They have internal, they have digestive issues, and they're just still coming. And I feel like they're lingering on my table.
Yeah.
Do you get what it's just?
I totally get it.
You know, so it's like.
That was a big part of my practice, AJ, was pain management.
The knee issue has been gone for months, but there's still something on my table because they want help. And I
right. Well, what I've realized, I mean, just from being an acupuncturist for 21 years now, is that if we include other tools like nutrition, like herbal therapy, like diet and lifestyle counseling, that we can become a better acupuncturist. My opinion is that for the modern patient, and you're seeing what I saw, which is that there's a lot going on other than the CC, the chief complaint, and there's so much more we can do to help them.
Yeah.
To change their lives for the better and help them in these other areas. And you have, you know, a wonderful patient base that loves you. And if you could say, hey, let's go work on those other things, and you change their life in a whole other way.
For sure.
And we can get better results in less time with our acupuncture and help people with a much broader range of issues beyond whatever our specialty is.
Yeah.
If we just have a bigger toolbox. Because my opinion is, and with all of my deep love for acupuncture, acupuncture isn't enough anymore. That's my opinion. I mean, you'll line up, a lot of people say otherwise, but my opinion, having practiced 26 years, I don't think acupuncture is enough anymore.
Well, you know, it's just a tool.
To truly, fully treat the modern patient.
Yeah, yeah.
All the way.
I mean, acupuncture is just a tool within our box, you know, and that being said, you know, it's just, you know, we're adding all these other things into it, and that's all it is. But
makes it, it augments. It just makes it better. Like I like to say, nutrition makes you a better acupuncturist.
Exactly. So, Mike, I want to thank you so much for coming on and sharing your knowledge. And for the listener, go to michaelgata.com and check out those websites that Michael had mentioned. And, if you want more information, reach out to Michael, reach out to me. We're just trying to help everybody, all right? So, Michael, I want to thank you so much for coming on.
Thanks, AJ. Appreciate the invitation. And thank you. I really want to appreciate and bless you for the amazing work you're doing. You're Acupuncturist on Fire. I've been following over the years, and I've just had a warm feeling seeing all the great stuff you're putting out to help our profession. I think I love it. I love what you're doing. I'm so thrilled that you're stepping out and making a difference for our profession. I just love what you're doing and how you're doing it. And I just really bless your efforts and your work and just so appreciate you and what you're doing.
Thank you so much. All right. This was AJ, and we'll catch you on the next one.
This has been the Acupuncturist on Fire podcast with AJ Adamczyk. To continue being inspired, head over to acupuncturistonfire.com and find AJ on Instagram at acupuncturistonfire.